So, former SEC chair Jay Clayton says crypto industry is pushing U.S. market infrastructure forward. Wait, if crypto is so powerful that it is the catalyst that's moving everything, the infrastructure, this is what he's saying, that's moving everything forward, how bullish do you think the future is for crypto? But wait a minute. Why now? You see, this is what I'm talking about. While the markets are down, while the markets are red, and they know, just like I do, when the markets are red, a lot of people stop listening to the crypto news. They stop watching videos. They stop reading articles. We all know this. We've experienced this, right? They know it also. So they put the information out when everything is down, when no one's paying attention, hoping that a lot of people won't see this. That the future of crypto is so bullish. Crypto is so, if you have something so powerful, there's no way it's not bullish. It's moving everything. But wait a minute, we're going to listen to him a little bit, right? Let's see how much more he tells. This also tells you how excited these people are about crypto. You think that they're not knee deep in crypto behind the scenes? They've been doing this for a long time, and stocks everywhere, they play dirty. They get in early. They shake other people out. They have insider things allegedly going on. You think that doesn't happen with crypto also? They don't know who the winners are going to be? I mean, you've seen countless industry giants backing certain crypto projects. Don't worry about the mainstream. Don't worry about what the people on the ground are saying. Look at what the big money is doing. Look at who they're backing. They're telling the people what's to come. I mean, there's no guarantees, but they're here to make big money, period, right? Crypto as a whole, those top cryptos, the top utility coins, and notice how all of them are putting emphasis on utility. But let's see what he has to say, right? Let's hear this out. They have this little clip here. I'm going to play it as loud as possible. Hopefully you can hear it. It begins at 54 seconds.
Yo, boom. How would you describe how far we've come in terms of like the state of crypto markets today from a market structure perspective? And then we can maybe get into policy later.
Sure, sure. Thanks, Frank. Nice to be here. Beautiful here. And I have to say the content of the conference is pretty remarkable.
It's robust.
It is. And there's, like we just talked about, there's a dose of reality.
Yeah.
Which I think you were never really.
He's buying himself time to figure out how to answer the question. That's why you have all this excessive verbiage. He doesn't initially know how to answer the question. He's buying himself time by talking about the conference and all this other stuff. He could have just jumped right into the question, but he doesn't want to. He has to be careful what he says. Now, fundamentally, what's the difference between crypto 3 years ago and crypto now? Crypto 4 years ago and crypto now, fundamentally, is still the same. If you're talking about the infrastructure, the mechanisms have advanced. But when we're talking about exchanges, I mean, the way the SEC deals with the exchanges or how the exchanges are set up, what's really the big change that has happened when it comes to exchanges or the essential nature of crypto? Maybe I'm wrong. Maybe you have a difference of opinion, but he's buying himself time. Let's keep it going.
Going to identify great opportunity without a dose of reality. And I think that's sort of permeating the conference here. And that helps answer your question, because if you look back to 2017, from a market structure perspective and a regulatory perspective, the exchanges were, I would say, immature.
Wait, stop. See how he's telling on himself? Wait, what's the big difference? The exchanges were immature in 2017 as opposed to now. Sure, if you want to talk about how new they were, okay, well, all right, maybe have an argument there. But really, what was the major change? Just some of them bent the knee and had to pay fines or had to see the SEC or had to bend the knee to the SEC? Is that it? You see, they want to bring everyone under their control. But who does the SEC, who do these regulatory agencies really represent? They represent a government that bends the knee to corporations. The corporations need to bend you to their will because they want to make large amounts of money off of you. It's the same way across all industries. That's the real difference here. That's really what he's talking about if you boil it down to its essence. Regulators control the exchanges and the various companies. Regulators work allegedly for the government, right? The government is pocketing tons and tons of value from donors and lobbyists. So they work for the donors and lobbyists. This is very simple. So now what are you witnessing? He's coming out now at a time when large industry players are taking over crypto, which tells us what? That tells us that at some point in the near future, I don't know specifically when, that major push is going to come, because those actors who have been putting things in place to take over crypto since 2017, whenever he's talking about, they're ready to flip that switch and make money off of it. They're here to make money off of it. That's why they've been wrestling with crypto, dominating it. You dominate something because you want to benefit from it. This is very simple. Let's keep it going. Come on, Mr. J. Clayton. What else are you going to tell us?
And blindly so. They were immature in two principal ways. One was a regulatory way.
A regulatory way? And how did that change? By paying large amounts of money to the SEC? What really changed? How did the SEC make anything better? How did they make them anything more secure? How did they protect the investor? They wrecked a bunch of investors. So that can't possibly be what the change was. No. See, now the exchanges have the realization of, oh, they want us to bend the knee. They want us to play their game. They want us to obey them. When they were free before, there was a lot of freedom in crypto before. Even when I came in 3 years ago, there was a lot of freedom in crypto. Crypto was run by the people, right? That's why the people were all gung-ho. Crypto and DeFi. Yeah, sure. They were running things. Now the people don't run crypto. Who runs crypto now? You got the BIS involved, IMF involved, the Fed. Oh, you know the Fed is deeply involved through a lot of different. Listen, the U.S. operates through a lot of private sector entities. Just know that. We're going to get to that a little bit later, especially with this next members-only video I'm going to drop. Let's keep going.
United States, we regulate the raising of capital, and in particular, the raising of capital from the retail public incredibly rigorously. And what those changes really didn't recognize is that...
See how he stuttered? He's not confident in what he said. Don't get me wrong. Someone like myself, I may fumble over words here and there, because somebody in the comment section definitely probably is saying that. Like, Mick, you stutter sometimes. I fumble sometimes. I don't stutter. I fumble over my words sometimes because I have so many different thoughts that I'm conveying on a daily basis. I'm trying to say something new every time. This man is not doing that. This man is not doing. You barely hear from this man. He barely speaks. He probably hasn't heard himself speak in a couple of days. I want to be real about it. I'm just joking. But yeah, you get my drift. No, he's not confident in his answer. Let's keep going.
They were facilitating capital raising in the ICO boom and the like in a completely out of bounds way. The second.
Why? Oh, he did. Ever notice how someone who's not telling the truth, but they have to stand next to a lie, they never elaborate. They never give you details. There was nothing wrong with what the crypto companies were doing. It's just that the big businesses, they saw what crypto was going to be. They needed to bring them to heel. They needed to bring them under control before this next explosion comes. They didn't care about all those other bull runs. We're the ones who think those bull runs were big. Well, not me anymore. I think they were great. Don't get me wrong. They had a lot of good capital off the last bull run, 2021. But that was nothing to them. They see the big picture, the trillions of dollars that are everywhere to scrape up. They see that. They know it's possible, while the regular retail investor has to question things and is getting moved all around by their favorite commentators. The industry people, they know they can go get that money. And so that's what this is all about. It's about that. So they'll, you know, when someone wants to take you down, they'll look at any little thing and try to pick at any little thing that they could say is wrong with you. It doesn't mean it's wrong with you. It just means that that's what they're trying to use to bring you down. If you come into agreement with that, then they will control you. And that's what this is really about. Go ahead and tell some more. He's telling. Tell some more. When people are, in my humble opinion, when people are corrupt, they tend to tell on themselves when you listen to them closely. A person with deductive reason can expose them.
Sophisticated, nefarious actors operate on exchanges. And the amount of...
Is that so, Mr. Clayton? You have a big problem with that. Can you please explain to me, or could you please elaborate on your problem as well with the multiples of massive lawsuits that the banks have had this year? Large banks, as a matter of fact, by not obeying your rules. Yeah, we follow that on this channel. Could you please elaborate on that? But you're not going to speak on them. Why? Because they're in your pocket. They're your boss. They're your controllers. They're in bed with all the other big companies. They're all really one. But you will not dare speak on that. There was a few large banks altogether that went to court this year and they lost because they literally would not obey your rules. That's not the only one, but let's keep going. But see how they'll nitpick with crypto because they have to bring crypto to heel. They did that. They slow crypto down enough to get in position. That's what it was all about. That's what I'm trying to say here. Let's keep going.
Wash sales and other manipulative transactions that were going on were way out of bounds from an acceptability point of view. Now, where are we? I think there's been a substantial maturation, particularly in the United States.
A substantial maturation in the United States. What has been the difference? Can you tell me? Please tell me in the comment section, what's the difference between then and now? The difference that I see is all the big companies have taken over. Once the Bank for International Settlements completed their research and they said that DeFi really wasn't decentralized, they found a way to take over DeFi, especially via liquidity pools, because whoever has the most liquidity in that liquidity pool or something like that, or with the automated market makers controls that, the money controls everything and they have big money. They have deep pockets. Once they figured out how to take over crypto, it was a wrap. That's the change. So now they can say crypto's good. Oh, crypto has matured. They're preparing you. They're preparing the world, conditioning them for when they say to everyone, hey, crypto's okay. And they flip that switch and they make all the money. They want to make all the money. They're shaking everybody else out. They're going to keep on squeezing the sponge and squeeze as many people out as they possibly can. You see it happening right now. While regular people are selling all their Bitcoin and selling everything else right now, and do what you want to do. It's not financial advice. I'm just a humble researcher with an opinion. But while the regular people are doing that, we've read multiple articles where the industry is buying. They're buying. They're taking it over. This is manipulation at its highest degree. That's just how I feel. That's what I think. Not feel. This is what I think. You can think opposite. We're different people. We have different thoughts. Let's keep it going.
Particularly in the United States, exchanges recognize that they can't be part of a securities offering where capital is being raised for investment without registration.
So, and you think it's, you believe it's okay that a security or the definition of a securities offering is being defined and established by an individual, Gary Gensler, who once praised and loved crypto and had zero problems with it until he became the head of the SEC. Then suddenly, magically, out of nowhere, he just changed his mind and all of crypto were securities. Can you please tell me, Mr. Clayton, why that happened? I'll wait. But really, I won't, because I know you won't do that, right? There is corruption there, in my humble, humble opinion. But you won't speak on that, which means you're part of it. But let's keep it going. And he's telling.
And I think you see this in the approval of the Bitcoin.
Let me stop right there also. All of what they're doing it was designed to put manacles on crypto, to control crypto, because when you control something, you can profit from it to the max. Let me say that again. When you control something, you can benefit from it and profit from it to the max. And there is no one who can do anything about it because you control it outright. There's no one to go against you. That's what this was about. And the game is still being played now.
The Ether ETF, other products, that people think the trading on these platforms is sufficiently efficacious, sufficiently free from manipulation, that the retail public should have access to these products.
What do you mean by that? Sufficiently efficacious, sufficiently beyond manipulation? Is that what you said? Why did you say manipulation? Why did you say that? Who's manipulating things?
In the most efficient form. So, okay, it's been, 7 years, but that is a substantial change.
Now, 7 years later, I think.
He said a lot. He said a lot, was saying a little. Notice that he was very careful with what he's saying. Very careful. Doesn't want to step on his boss's toes.
If we had, executives from any of the crypto exchanges sitting with us, they would argue we still don't have clarity.
See that? The executives, thank goodness crypto has some dogs, some lions. You know how they say you have a dog in dog in a fight, and they have this phrase now where they say you got some dog in you. That means you fight. Thank goodness crypto has some executives that fight. Yes, they would say there's no clarity because there's not. Nothing has changed, but he says that there was a big change. Why would he say that? You see, there's always a little bit of truth in some of these lies, right? I believe he's saying that because there was a big change. The companies took over. And that's why these types of actors can now praise crypto and talk about how it's changing the infrastructure in the U.S. In the U.S.? We haven't even seen much happen in the U.S. So what is he talking about, really? You see, you got to ask these questions. Why? What do you mean by that? It's a rare person to ask questions. Let's keep going. Let's see if he says any more.
On which of these assets are securities and which of these assets are commodities. And it's funny in hindsight, well, you know, maybe not for you. I think back when you were chairman of the agency, you said something to the effect of 90.
If you really wanted to know which of these were commodities or securities or whatever, then you wouldn't have battled against the CFTC when the CFTC wanted to step in and list which ones they thought by their studies were commodities. But you, the SEC, said no, no, no. And you battled them. You can't have it both ways. You're lying. You're lying. Respectfully, I say, you're lying. And I'm calling you out on it. If you really want to know that, why not get out of the way of the people that can actually establish what's a commodity? But when they said, oh, this is a commodity, that's a commodity, you said, no, it's this other thing here. Right? You can't have it both ways. You either want it or you don't. But that's what a liar does. You're stumbling now. Let's keep going.
90%
in my humble opinion.
Of these tokens are unregistered securities. And I think maybe back then people thought that was an overstatement. Probably wasn't.
I think it's a lie, but that's just me. Keep going.
If you think back to those.
I think you want your hands. No, not your hands. Your hands are on the cash that was put, not yours literally, Mr. Clayton, but probably, I don't know. Just I don't know you personally. But the SEC's and regulators' hands are on the cash that was put in their pockets by a lot of these big companies. The big companies want to have their hands on the value that's going to come from trillions of dollars in real world asset tokenization and everything else. I think the whole interbank payments and B2B cross-border payments capital that'll flood in when they say go, I think that's just sprinkles on top compared to all the RWA that will be tokenized. That's what this is all about. This is the biggest war and battle over capital of all time, because there will never, ever again be this type of capital made when that switch is flipped, period. Whether people like it or not, believe it or not, that's the opportunity that is at hand. Whether it happens or not, there's no guarantees in life. No one, not even the people with all the money in the world, can guarantee anything. However, that's what this is about. The biggest gold rush, the biggest capital value rush that has ever existed before. Period. Look at my face and how serious I am about that. That's what this is about. This is what they want. That's why all this is happening. That's why it's taking so long. That's why there's so many battles. So much manipulation, psychological warfare being deployed. It is what it is. Let's keep going.
Hassley on heady days. But I think that even still, while I think people would argue that you're maybe more of an advocate for the space now, they would say we're...
He's more of an advocate for crypto now. Really? Why now? I think you know why. We're going to stop right there. Let's go here. All right. We have some more articles that show you the change that is coming. That shows you, while they're distracting everybody with all the negativities and such that will pass like they always do, all of these things are coming out. Look at this right here. What is this? Real-time payments reach key milestones in the U.S., Switzerland, and Australia. Wait a minute. This is what he's talking about. You see, crypto is so tasty. DLT is so tasty. It's so good at what it does. It's been forcing the legacy system to attempt to catch up. They just haven't been able to do it. And they're not going to be able to do it. That's why they're all integrating with DLT services. That's why that article came out saying how Ripple was going to be going after the small banks. That's huge. People don't understand how big that is. Small banks plus local digital currencies equal the possibility of skyrocketing prices for a few of the top utility coins that are bank coins in the future. Period. That's how it goes. That opportunity is there. There's no guarantees. They have to go and get that money and execute, of course, but that is there. This is what Jay Clayton's talking about. They've been pressuring the systems in the U.S. And when he talks about that aspect, sure, I can agree with that. But we all know that. He's just reiterating what we have said, the pros in crypto and DLT have said for countless years. But let's read this little tidbit here. It says real-time payments continue their rapid global expansion. But let's be clear about this. They don't have global reach. Some of them reach from US to Europe, UK. Some of them have, reach from China, Japan, Philippines. They're all siloed. If you have a limited reach, you are siloed. If you have a limited reach and there's a multitude of central bank digital currency systems, DLT systems, then that is increased fragmentation. So while they're talking about rapid, right? Because you apply that in some ways as well, right? Rapid global expansion. They also should put in here that there's rapid fragmentation. Oh, Mick, you're the only one saying it. No, I'm not. Janet Yellen literally said that. Janet Yellen literally was telling people her concern is about fragmentation. Did you see the articles? Because I posted it in the videos. So we have the people at the top, you know, they're not really pros, but then you have other people like myself, researchers, on our detective job, and we are seeing the same thing, rapid fragmentation, which means what? That makes it better for the private sector. That makes it better for companies like Ripple, Stellar, Algorand, Quant, Flare, Chainlink, that say they're going to connect everything together and bring this interoperability together, because then they have something to connect. And then that value has to flow through them. They don't have to worry about this or that company using the native coin directly. No, but when you need to send this money over there, then you need a bridge currency. Boom, there you go. So that's constant value flowing through those at some point. What does it do to that price? You tell me. It says with banks, governments, updating existing systems. Why now? Why the rapid global expansion now? Because they've taken over and the time is near. When is near? When, Moon, Mick? I don't know. I just know that it looks like the next year or two, maybe. That's just my humble opinion. I don't work for a government. I don't work for a bank. I don't know these people or their nefarious plans. I don't know. But I'm telling you what I see. It looks like they're getting ready. They're getting ready. Something's coming. I can tell you what. I don't know what you're going to do. I don't control you. I just know I'm going to be there. If I'm alive and I'm breathing, I'm going to be there to see what this is at the end. Because it looks like something huge is coming. Then they talk about Australia. Who's deep in Australia? Ripple. Ripple, for the last like 2 years, they've had partnerships which they've gone quiet about with banks in Australia. Also, Hedera allegedly at one time had some ties to a bank or two in Australia. Look that up for yourself. Hedera's in there as well. So they go into a little bit of that. And then Switzerland. Who's deep in Switzerland? I believe that's what we read recently, right? There were two large entities that Ripple was working with in Switzerland over the summer that was announced, I believe. Check that out for yourself. I'm going off the top of my head. I believe it was Switzerland. So all of these areas, bank coins are deep in true global reach. Heck of an advantage, I'm telling you. All right, so now let's go here because I have no idea how long this video is now. I have no idea. We're going to skip this article. Let's go to some Bitcoin. I want to get to the Bitcoin because a lot of people enjoy the Bitcoin news and are Bitcoin holders here. So I want to keep my word. And I enjoy covering the Bitcoin as well as a Bitcoin holder myself. Bitcoin to reach $200,000. Anthony Scaramucci of Skybridge Capital makes a bold prediction. Let's see if he feels the same way that I do. Nothing that's happening now has changed the trajectory of what Bitcoin can do in the future. It hasn't. Bitcoin is super bullish. It's never been more bullish than now, period. I'm not talking about how the price looks today. I'm talking about long term. No, there looks like an explosion coming. All the catalysts are there. All the big companies are knee deep in Bitcoin. You think that they got knee deep in Bitcoin to not make capital? I like to say that all the time. It drives a certain point home. It says Skybridge Capital co-founder and managing partner Anthony Scaramucci has predicted that Bitcoin will hit $150,000 to $200,000. I called it for $150,000. That's why. That's why I believe. But if it goes higher, I'll take that. Why not? But I'm not married to Bitcoin. I will move that Bitcoin so fast, it's not even funny. I will sell that Bitcoin so fast, it's not even funny. And then if it dips, well, I'll take it. I'll take it there when it gets there. Soon enough, in an interview with Schwab Network, the crypto OG. What are you trying to be cool? OG. You know, OG doesn't mean original, right? It means original gangster. That's what it meant. You do know that, right? Well, you probably don't know that. So you just use an OG because it's cool, popular. I don't like when people try to be cool or popular. I like when people are just themselves. Just be you. Use your own verbiage. Just be you. Like, that is me, Mick. Then you would know what OG means. He's not an original gangster. But anyway, let's go. Oh, man. I don't know. Those little things are my pet peeves. My teacher would be proud of me. Crypto OG noted that this would happen as the number of Bitcoin wallets hits 1 billion. Notably, really, that's what you believe? All right, so teach his own. Notably, Bitcoin wallets are currently on the rise amid a surge in adoption. Data from Chainalysis shows there were over 460 million Bitcoin wallets as of March 2024, with 10% of them holding at least $1. I read that wrong. Further wallet analysis reveals that there are currently 78 million Bitcoin wallets with at least $1, showing an increased inclination to the asset. Scaramucci noted that he sees Bitcoin trading at a market cap closer to gold. I'm gonna let that one slide right there. Okay, it's possible. Sure, to each his own. You have your own thoughts. Gold is in a class of its own. Please, people, stop comparing Bitcoin to gold. Bitcoin, I love sometimes. Gold, I love forever. The Sky Bridge, they said they spelled it Sky Bridge. I know it's a typo, but that looks funny. The Sky Bridge co-founder asserted that Bitcoin was a store of value like gold. No. Sir. You and I both know. How long you been into gold, sir? I'm assuming that you've been in gold for a long time. I'm going to assume that. I shouldn't. My father always told me don't assume anything. My father used to say, if you assume things, you make yourself the first three letters of that word. Should I take the chance on you, sir? Anyway, those who've been in gold for a long time love gold, and they that base layer of value that's in gold stays there. Stays there. People love to take out their bars of gold and count it. They do it on social media all the time. They're counting their bars of silver, bars of gold. I mean, there's nothing like gold. Nothing like gold. Bitcoin is great. It's a moneymaker. People sell Bitcoin all the time. I'm holding Bitcoin for a long. I'm a long-term holder. I'm a maxi. Then you see them selling their Bitcoin like it's hotcakes. This is not the same thing. Bitcoin is a moneymaker. All the experts that I've read from, agree with that. Like right now, Bitcoin is not the store of value it's supposed to be. It's a money maker. People look at gold as a pure store of value. Protect your wealth at all costs. Banks go down, people are running to gold and money market funds. Only a few going to go to Bitcoin. Although Bitcoin will get a little action and maybe it'll become that in the future. But I respectfully disagree. You have your own opinion. I have mine. It says, as a result, its value should correlate with that of the precious metal. I don't agree with that at all. Although I believe that Bitcoin will explode for very different reasons. I believe the big companies know Bitcoin is a moneymaker. They're going to press the people at some point. Yes, press them. They're going to have massive media runs. That's all it takes is for the media everywhere that the people love on all these big networks to come on and tell them these are the people they've been watching since they were yay high. Come on the news and tell them, hey, Bitcoin is good. You know, this bank is promoting Bitcoin and they say it's good and they're saying all this good stuff. I know I'm not being so eloquent in this, but you get my drift. And the people will come and the companies, Bitcoin will skyrocket. It already will have skyrocketed from all the big company buying, but then the people will add their capital and then the companies will sell on them and they will take that Bitcoin. They will take that value. In my humble opinion, and it will be a rinse and repeat process. I don't know how Bitcoin escapes the volatility if that scenario does play out, but it will probably be a permanent moneymaker until they have something new to push. But I'll leave that one there. All right. I like a lot of what Anthony Scaramucci has to say when it comes to certain cryptos and stuff like that. He used to be a big Algorand supporter as well. I remain an Algorand supporter, period. Now that you have that information, what are you going to do with it? I know what I'm going to do with it, folks. So until next time, let's get to the money.